Before I start, I just want to give you a sense of what we're going to do today. This is an opportunity, basically, for many of you who have even read the book or have heard about the book, to have that opportunity to speak to Sanam about it. So what we're going to do is we're going to start off with a few questions. Sanam will read from the book as well, and then pretty much it's your opportunity to, you know, converse on what you found interesting about the book, or what, you know, what you observed during the entire sort of period that this book talks about in terms of your own experience. That will be the opportunity to talk to her, because that's what I want you to basically get out of this, is that opportunity to interact. Now, I've been following Sanam Maher's work for quite a while. It feels like about 5-7 years.
Yeah.
And Sanam's work's been appearing essentially in, I think it was Al Jazeera, BuzzFeed is new to me. I saw it predominantly in the New York Times. There was a wonderful women's section, Caravan, which is an Indian publication.
Yeah.
I didn't know, but the BFI Sights and Sound was also somewhere that you wrote as well. And each time, perhaps the articles that resonated the most with me were the ones that tended to tackle women's issues. She's written widely. She's written on culture, business, politics, religious minorities, women. But there were a lot of stories that struck me as very unique when it came to sort of like talking about the female experience. And one of the stories that I think maybe a lot of people have spoken to about is her, when she covered the women's boxing club in the RE, which is a particular favorite of mine, because I love reading the stories. If I could retweet it over and over again, I would. But that was such a, I could see the strength of her writing behind these stories, because I was really moved by what, not just the subject matter, but how she tackled it so empathetically and with a great deal of humanity in her writing. I'm very glad to see that that's exactly what she brought to her first book, is that right? First book of non-fiction, which I have to say is a remarkable feat. I'm going to sit down and ask her a couple of questions, and then we'll take it forward and see how the evening evolves. So thank you so much, Sanam.
Thank you
for joining us today.
Like, people ask me, when are you going to write another book? And just the ego boost you get from stuff like this, I'm like, I'll do another book just for this. Like, keep doing my bio and keep telling people about me. It's great. So yeah.
Also, if you can't hear anything, then what I would suggest, especially for the newcomers, the carpets are at the front for you to sit on. It will give you the best possible vantage point for this talk. So please do not feel shy. Come and occupy the carpet. You will not regret the opportunity to interact that you will have. If you find that you can't hear us, just give us a bit of a shout, and we will sort of take it up an octave or two. Okay. All right. So again, I wanted to welcome you, and I wanted to ask you. This is a very interesting book in that I'm not quite sure what to expect when I set out to read a book on Qandeel Baloch, but I found that I was encountering a lot more than just that one individual personality. I think I was encountering aspects of Pakistan that I'm familiar with, that also this rather unique personality had to navigate as well. There's so much in this book. Did you intend it to be a book about Qandeel Baloch, or did you intend it to be as all-encompassing as it turned out to be?
It was a bit of both. Can the people in the back, can you hear me okay? Yeah? Okay. It was a bit of both. Obviously, at the outset, the thing that interested me was Qandeel. This was when her murder had just happened. I had been approached by a couple of publishers who were interested in me writing anything. And I was really lucky because they literally were like, anything you're interested in right now, what would you like to pitch us? And that was on the 4th or 5th of July, and this happened on the 15th.
Yeah.
So it was kind of this really great chain of events where I saw this happen, and I was watching TV, the news broke, and for me, the biggest sort of the the thing that got me interested was this idea of a woman who managed to fool everyone around her, who managed to fool us as an audience. We had a really certain idea of her, who she was. And then also just being a part of the media, I was kind of amazed that up until sort of the end, when her husband came forward and then it was revealed that she had a child and she had been married, we didn't really know anything about her. We were just kind of relentlessly consuming this image and this idea of her. And no one had sort of paused to say, which happens a lot with people who are kind of in the limelight, inevitably something comes out or something about their background or some gossip or something like that. And she had created this persona which we were very keen on consuming, whether it was to hate her, to send her horrible messages, or tell her we loved her. And so it was this idea of how do you fool people around you? How do you create this personality, especially as a woman in Pakistan who has such a public persona? And then kind of moving beyond that, when I saw the reaction that came to the murder, there was always, you know, the most interesting thing was, and you guys would have seen this a lot, where people say, this is so bad that it happened, and then there's a big but. There's a big but in all those conversations. So, but what did she expect? But what else did she think would happen? You know, is tarah ke kaam kar rahi thi, toh this is the natural conclusion. And for me, then it became a lot about us and us as an audience. And also this question of what can a woman do that is so bad that the natural response to that is to end her life? What could you do that is so terrible that that seems normal to a lot of people? It seems accepted, and it just seems like, well, of course that was going to happen. So from there, it started off obviously with her, and I was amazed by her and kind of fascinated. But then it also moved into, who are we when we're looking at this image? What are we seeing reflected back to us? Why are we so taken with it? Why were we dying to watch everything that she put out? How did she kind of get into this place? So it was a bit of both, really.
I think you also talk quite a lot, because obviously this is what comes out of research and subject matter, about class as well.
Yeah.
I mean, Qandeel was a person that people interacted with in terms of the reactions they had to the, to her videos, but there was also this class divide.
Yeah.
Could you tell us a little bit about how you felt hearing people's responses after she died, in terms of this martyr that they had created, mm-hmm. but in all reality there was a disconnect because she was glamorous, but not in a way that you would expect glamorous of a certain class to be.
Yeah.
So there was a bizarre sort of consumption that was verging on ridicule, because she didn't come from a background for which this behavior was expected.
Yeah.
So
I think that I took my cues from her in terms of that. She, just this idea that she had created, if you watch her videos or if you kind of followed her on social media, or even just in her interviews, she did a lot of interviews where she would say, you know, I don't need to do this. I just do it because I like it. This is something I enjoy. Or she would say, my father is a landlord and we have all this land. And so we're very rich. We're really well off. And I make these videos when, you know, the rest of my family is sleeping and it's at night and I'm bored. And I think that she understood to some extent who gets to get away with certain kinds of behavior, where it might just be a couple of people trashing you or complaining about you, but you kind of come out at the other end without much happening to your image. And I think that she was really aware that if you are someone from a certain background, I hate saying background, but like we all know what that means, right? And you have a certain kind of family, or you do these things not because it's a grubby commercial thing that you do because it's making you money. You just do it because, oh, I like putting up a selfie of mine. Or there's no compulsion behind it, right? There's no monetary sort of gains that you're getting, which then puts you in another category.
Yeah.
And so I took my cues from that a lot, that why did she want to cultivate this image of herself as somebody who didn't need to do this, as somebody who had this whole family and this family life and we're so well off and my brother is in the army, which was true, but where did that come from? And then when it kind of came to the reaction, and I don't want to trash anybody that felt you know, sort of really connected to her in that way. The people that I did have a problem with were people who, and I'm sure you guys would have seen this as well, where they were kind of horrible about her all along. There were a lot of journalists who did this. And then she died, and then they deleted a lot of their tweets, and it became, she's such a feminist, we're so sad to have lost her, we felt so connected with her. But then you also saw a lot of women who were doing these op-eds about her, who were talking about her in ways in which they had never, they'd never celebrated those things about her. They'd never said, well, she's so brave, or she did this. And it was a very sort of, acha bichari ke saath ye ho gaya. So now it's okay for me to say, I feel bad for this, or I feel bad about this thing that happened. So that was also kind of something that just bugged me. Why do you suddenly feel it's okay? Once the punishment has happened as such, then it's safe. It's all right to talk about it. There were a lot of women who genuinely did feel that, and this isn't to say anything about them. And I know that when they did express sadness about what had happened, they were attacked as well online, to the point where a lot of people shut down their Twitter accounts, or they just kind of went off it for a while, things like that. But class kind of, I took my cues from her, that why was it important to be this person? What did that mean? So.
But that's kind of interesting, because then that means that your subject matter, I guess out of necessity, was building a persona, which would make it acceptable to do these sorts of things, because you felt that one class, for one class it was acceptable behavior, but for another it would not be seen as...
It's cheap for another.
Or there are certain repercussions.
Yeah.
But then again, that makes her a very unreliable source.
Yeah.
And as one reads the book, she's not the only unreliable person in many ways. There are a lot of people that we see in her life that appear, and this is what you capture wonderfully, they appear as being unreliable narrators of their experience with her.
Yeah.
How was that for you to know that this is what you have to go off?
Difficult.
And you don't know.
Really difficult. This is completely at a remove from my day job, or just what I had been. I've been a journalist since 2007, and the whole thing there is, you aren't in an article putting out, well, maybe this thing happened, but this thing also could have happened, and I don't actually know what happened. No one is running those kinds of stories. But with this, a huge part of the problem was, well, firstly, I started, she was killed in July. I started interviewing people in sort of end of September. And by that point, everyone had sort of circled around this story. So there were journalists, not just in Pakistan, but people flying into Pakistan. The story was covered internationally. It was a huge amount of attention. And sort of the main people, when you think about her family, her siblings, people in the village, even Mufti Kavi, they had already been interviewed so many times that a lot of them were either at a point where they didn't want to be interviewed, they were fed up with it. That happened with a lot of people in her village. Or it was, they had a certain script almost. Some people who loved that media attention, they would feed me the lines that they thought I wanted to hear, because they knew that's what gets quoted, that's what gets them in the news, and they liked that. And then with other people, it was, you know, this thing of having to just spend a lot of time with them to get past that script. And a lot of their memories at that point were also, I mean, someone dies, this thing happens, and there's this massive reaction that they can see. So their response is also slightly filtered by that reaction, but it's also, if someone has died, you're not gonna be talking shit about them at the end of the day. You have to be a certain kind of person to do that. So I knew that that was a problem that I was having to deal with, just because that was coming forward in the interviews. And the sort of best way to deal with it, like even just with Qandeel herself, I'd never met her, never interviewed her, never even spoken with her at all. It was just an engagement on social media. And when I started doing these interviews, I would sort of, I'd have these moments where, you know, I do one interview and I'm like, okay, this is great. I have this part of her personality nailed down, or this part of her character, or this time in her life, or this event. Like, okay, good, like that's done. And then I do the next interview, and all of that stuff that I was so certain about, it was completely sort of up in the air again. And this was something I was constantly having to deal with, to the point where even when I was in Multan, the first couple of interviews that I started doing, they started in Multan. And I'd been consuming all the news about this event, everything that had possibly been put out there. And I also went to Multan with a certain idea, ki acha ye hua tha, and this is what these people are like, and this is probably what I'm gonna get from them. When I started doing the interviews and spending time with them and spending a lot of time sort of just being there, observing them, all of that also went up in the air. And I understood that everything that we're seeing is a certain narrative that's been created. And that's because you have constraints of time, constraints of space, you have a certain sort of angle that you need to get across. And so there was so much uncertainty that the main way for me to respond to that was to put it all in the book. This was my experience of researching this story. Yeah. And this is what you get when you're consuming a certain story about her that is trying to tell you, oh, this is the real story, yeah, or this is the inside story, or I have the authentic version. What is the authentic version? Yeah. Even just with a person, if we think of just any of us, if I wanted to do a story on you, who do you trust in your life that I could go to and they would give me the truest or the most authentic or the real version of you that you want me to know? With your partner or someone else, with your boyfriend, girlfriend, sibling, parents, co-workers, you're a different person with different people. And Qandeel was that to the nth degree. So I also reached a point where I realized even if I had interviewed her, that was just one facet that I would have been getting. It wouldn't have helped me get to the real Qandeel or this real story. That real was a manufactured real that I had also been consuming, and I just didn't want to be a part of that, to tell people, this is 100% the definitive book on Qandeel. You don't need anything else. Yeah. I think you need a lot else even after reading this, and that was the whole point of it.
It's interesting because a lot of the people who are unreliable are also people who either were able to enjoy the monetary sort of results of her doing these videos, or were people who had exploited her in another shape or form.
Right.
So, I mean, this is interesting because this is a theme that I saw pretty much through the book, that when women begin to work, there's a certain exploitation that takes place in Pakistan. It's almost a given. Is this for you a reality, that if you want to enter the workplace, it's going to be full of essentially a lot of people preying on you?
I think it's a reality for a lot of women here. I mean, we all know that. It's definitely something that I think we're starting to talk about a lot more. It's definitely something that you see in the book a lot with all of the women who are working. Whether you say achha ye achhi background ki hai ya ye low class hai ya whatever it is, you do encounter that in some form. I think it's kind of a given at this point.
Yeah, it's an unfortunate reality. But when you have this lady who's in the modeling field as well, that really it really went into detail of, because it's such a female-centric industry,
right,
the level of exploitation and how little money they made. I was horrified to hear how little, $1,000 a piece?
Yeah, it was like $1,000, $2,000, maybe $3,000.
Yeah.
I mean, like what you'd pay for your phone bill.
And this was this was what you were earning. Pittance, complete and utter pittance. This is also, I find interestingly enough, a book about social media.
Yeah.
Probably the only book about social media in Pakistan and the effects. Was that what you were looking to do, to write about social? Because you go into a lot of phenomena, a lot of social media celebrities.
Yeah.
So was that something you intended to do as well?
Again, it was something that kind of the more that these were things that I was also interested in before, right? I think all of us, these are certain things that we are starting to consider a lot more now. Not just in terms of how toxic social media can be, or how trolls work, or how haters work, or just how the space is being used, but we're a generation of Pakistanis that's connected to the world like no other generation before us. It is so easy for us now, where the ways in which we behave online are very disconnected to our offline spaces. And to me, it's interesting that you are kind of rooted in a certain place, in a certain space, within a certain culture, and maybe what you're seeing is 5 years ahead of that, 10 years, 20 years, in terms of attitudes, in terms of how you present yourself, in terms of your ambitions for yourself, in terms of, you know, you being able to kind of have this whole world of opportunity, and you're stuck physically in a certain space. Mm. And when there's a disconnect like that, how does that manifest? And what happens with something like that? So when you have Arshad, the Chaiwala, his story is also in here. What happens with someone when they kind of are in a certain space from a certain family, they've lived a certain life, and they get yanked out of that and then put into this completely separate zone where we're sort of consumers of this image. It's a completely different lifestyle. It's a different way of being, a different way of earning money. And then we kind of get sick of him. So then he doesn't belong here in the first space, and he doesn't belong here because we're not interested. What happens when you're in a gray zone and you're in the middle and you don't really belong on either side? What happens to someone like that? It's all well and good to sort of like Tahir Shah, like, oh, it's so funny and the song is so funny and his outfit is so funny, and now we're kind of bored, and maybe he's going to come out with something else. That's, but what is happening with him, right? I tried to get him in the book as well, but you have to pay him to meet him. And it starts at a lakh, in case anyone wants to. But yeah, that was even moving beyond social media stars. When you look at someone like Naila Rind, who's just a student at this university, and these pictures come out of her, and someone.
Tell the audience just a little bit about,
so this is
a tragic tale.
This is a story. I mean, this book honestly kind of, well, I was at a point where it was starting to sprawl, so I became like a hoarder, where I would see all these interesting stories that would be connected to Qandeel in some way, and I'd be like, okay, that one also has to go in, and this one also has to go in, and I had a year to do this. So just to kind of give you an estimate of how terrible, but my time management was ridiculous, because I started writing it in April, and I had to get done in July. That was it. And it was, by the end, hoarder, 125 interviews that were just there, and how do you jam pack it into this? And so Naila was the story that I came across, and I really was, I knew I had to put it in here somehow. She was a girl at the University of Sindh. I don't know if you guys in Lahore would have seen this as much, but it really played out in Karachi and sort of Hyderabad. She was at the University of Sindh. She was going out with this guy. She wanted to marry him. She was from a conservative family from Balochistan. And she got done with her degree and she was like, okay, it's time to get married now. And he was like, I'm not interested, and I have all these pictures of you. He had a lot of photographs of her that he'd taken, she wasn't aware of, a lot of sort of pictures that could have played out very badly for her family. And she hanged herself. And there was a lot of sort of talk at that time. There was a lot of conversation, theoretical conversation, about the Cyber Crimes Act, if you guys remember that. And this thing happened right then. And so Nigar Dad and her organization, they also put out this open letter that, you know, you guys are discussing it in these ways, and we're pushing for, you know, why does this need to be better? Because when it happens, when something like this happens to a girl who's blackmailed with these photos of hers, where, you know, it could have horrible repercussions if the guy had sent it to her family or whatever it is, what happens then? How does legislation, there's a huge disconnect between, you can have all the legislation in the world, how does it play out for someone like a young girl who's a university student, and then she ultimately hangs herself because she figures there's no other way out of this. And so a lot of these stories kind of came forward because I had been interested in this all along, and this was a great opportunity to jam everything in. But also, these are the interviews that I was doing. This is what was coming forward. And with Qandeel as well, how could you not include something like that?
Yeah.
So,
you have a portion that you'd like to read from
yes.
the book?
Yes. Okay. So, just show of hands, who's read the book here? Just so I... Okay, great. Good. So, new stuff. Okay. This is the chapter on the Chaiwala. Not everyone seeks fame. Sometimes fame, the kind some people spend their entire lives courting, finds you. It is this kind of overnight fame that comes unannounced to a 17-year-old boy, a beautiful, fair-skinned, blue-eyed boy with a brooding stare, in October 2016, when he becomes one of the most recognizable faces in Pakistan. In just 5 days, two photographs of him on the social media site Instagram rake in more than 50,000 likes and thousands of comments. His fame spreads not just in Pakistan, but around the world. His good looks are featured on CNN. The BBC notes that his piercing eyes have thousands of Twitter followers love-struck, and BuzzFeed describes him as damn hot, with effortless high-fashion model looks. Very soon, he is charming audiences on morning talk shows and being showered with offers to model and act, smiling and posing for countless photographs and receiving a stream of marriage proposals. There have been many firsts for him this month: sitting in a chauffeur-driven car, flying in an airplane, staying in a hotel, buying his first suit. Before his newfound fame, he sold tea for a living in a market in Islamabad, and he would worry about how to earn enough to make sure everyone in his family, his father, his two mothers, and 17 siblings had enough to eat. Now he dines at five-star restaurants. What does he like to eat? Bhindi. His name is Arshad Khan, and he has become known in Pakistan and around the world as the Chaiwala. He is famous for having done absolutely nothing. Arshad was working at a dhaba in a Sunday bazaar in Islamabad's G9 neighborhood one October day when Javeria Ali, a 26-year-old photographer who was on a photo walk in the market, spotted him ladling cups of milky tea. He was wearing a turquoise-colored shalwar kameez with a white scallop trim around the neck. His hair was slightly tousled, with a few stray locks falling above his dark eyebrows, and his cheeks were peppered with stubble. He wore a black thread looped around his wrist to protect him from the evil eye. Ali routinely shot portraits of street children, pushcart vendors, and beggars, uploading the images to her Facebook page where she advertised her wedding photography services and classes for aspiring photographers. This portrait felt no different. She took three or four pictures while the Chaiwala's head was bowed down. He looked up for a split second and stared right at her. She got the shot. Arshad didn't even realize his photograph had been taken. Ali uploaded the photograph, captioned "Hot Tea," to her Instagram and Facebook pages on October 14th. It was soon shared on various blogs and social media pages, with users commenting on the stunning looks of the ordinary tea boy. Should I go on, or is this?
I think
we're good. Okay.
But it's a remarkable telling of Arshad's experience, because it's the kind of stuff we knew, but it wasn't. We weren't told the story. We were always told, his parents told him to give it up. But you never really understand the circumstances that he had to endure in order to come out the end doing something that we think almost unthinkable, which is to give up fame and fortune. But I think it was really important to include that.
Yeah, he was great to meet. He was such a sweet kid. He is such a sweet kid. And now he's kind of gone. We're not interested anymore. And I think this blueprint that Qandeel created, how to keep attention going, how do you move beyond just sort of flash in the pan, viral star, how I'm looking, oh, amazing video, love to make fun of it, make dub smash. But then how do you translate that into months and months of interest? How do you get on talk shows? How do you get on primetime TV? Mm. How do you get Mubashir Luqman interviewing you? How do you get on Jio's Eid special? How do you translate that split second into that? And I think that's something Arshad didn't, and a lot of people don't manage to do.
Yeah.
So.
I do want to open up the floor to questions. So is there anybody that has any questions and
comments,
because now is your opportunity. So, even at all, go ahead. You seem like you have a question. Yeah.
No.
No.
Sorry.
Yes. Go ahead.
Why don't you shed some light on the model? That was my favorite chapter, as you know, about the model who was ultimately told that her time was up.
On the models chapter.
Yes. What became of her?
I don't know what became of her. It was, I went there to meet Qandeel's manager, and he manages these girls, and they were having a fashion show, a rehearsal for a fashion show on that day. And so suddenly I had all of these characters, and it was start talking to them and see what is going on with them and how do they live, what do they do, why did they get into this, and kind of setting the scene for what would have, because Qandeel worked in this same scene, in this sort of not fashion scene in the way that you think of like fashion shows that are sort of very marketed. These are just kind of regular, just some small designer, a bunch of girls get together, and it's a fashion show that happens, and they get paid like 2,000, 3,000, and they want to be models. They're aspiring to get to that level where they're on a billboard, in an ad, in a movie, in a music video. And so I started talking to them, and Hushi, who's the main character in that chapter, she just had a fantastic story and just how she got to that point and what she did and how she got sucked into this modeling world, and then kind of it spit her out. What does she do now? She's a personal trainer now. But I don't know what happened to that girl. I don't see her on social media. They want to have you around. They're okay with you being there. They're okay with you kind of meeting their family, being in their homes, whatever. And I ended up spending 7 hours with Mufti Kavi. And it was the meeting his family, being in his home. It was very difficult to stay neutral. Even like, I wasn't even trying to be neutral. I think it was okay, don't just show revulsion. That was the baseline. But I think the thing that I came out with the most over there was a lot of the stuff that he said. It was amazing to hear it, to hear his version of what had happened with Qandeel, or what kind of transpired in the room, and then why did that happen, what was she trying to do, and then what happened with her in the end. His response to it, how he had processed that, what he thought about it. It was kind of amazing to hear it, but it was a lot of his responses about women as well, how he thinks about them or how he thinks about himself. I felt a lot of anger about that, and it was amazing to me that ordinarily, I think in a theoretical sense, if someone had told me this, I would have been like, why didn't you just say something to him? Or why don't, we see this a lot when people talk about their, maybe like a horrible experience in a workplace, or some, you know, guy says something to you that's slightly strange and kind of inappropriate. And we all say, main to usko jawab de deti, main to ye kehti, main to this, you should have done this, you should have. And when I was in that position and I could have said something, it was very, very difficult. And so just difficult in the sense that you're surrounded by these guys who are his followers. You're dealing with this man that has a certain status or whatever it is. Obviously, I'm there in a work capacity. I'm not there to sort of squabble with him. But it really struck me how much it takes to call out a man like that and to talk back to a man like that who does something where, if you say this happened with me, a lot of people are going to cast doubt on you, which is exactly what happened with Qandeel. We were very suspicious of her. Kamre mein kya kar rahi thi? Why did you take selfies? Why were you there? What were you doing there? What kind of girl goes there? Obviously, you're a whore, right? It's difficult to call out someone like that. Even more difficult to stick to your position and for whatever reason that she did it. I think that's a moment when I really was struck by, it takes a lot of guts to do something like this, especially as a woman in Pakistan who's calling out someone that has a certain position, that has a certain status, that has this whole sort of machinery behind him, followers and influential people and whatever. And that was an interview where I really sort of had the worst.
I think he's interesting because he's constructed himself into this gatekeeper of women in Islam.
Yeah.
And it's probably the most inappropriate person to try and take on this mantle. So it's very, it's disturbing.
It was disturbing.
And
it was 7 hours of disturbing.
Yeah. So you managed to get 7 hours.
Yeah, so he gave me 30 minutes. And then when I saw that, you know, he's someone who, he's kind of scared, he's kind of nervous, he's worried about how I'm going to perceive him. I got this sense from him that he is someone who thrives on female attention, who thrives on, you know, you being attentive, you asking questions in a very certain way. And I got those signals from him. So I am going to be that person. I don't want 30 minutes. I want as much time as he can give me to move beyond this rehearsed answer that he would have done.
Yeah.
So I was that person. He wanted that person there. It was 7 hours. And yeah.
Job well done. He gave us an insight. Yeah.